Hi everyone, I'm Finola Howard, and today I want to introduce you to one of our expert panel, and or someone who's on our expert panel, and it is the wonderful Fiona McKenna, who I know for about 5 years now, which I can't believe we were just talking about. And she, in my mind, is that CFO extraordinaire. So I want you to meet her because I know she can help you. So I'm going to give it over to Fiona and let her give you a quick rundown of her background. And let's just talk about her background first, and then we can talk about how she could help you. Great. Fiona, lovely to see you. Excellent. So tell us a little bit about your background.
Right. Well, I know you wouldn't think it from the lovely blonde locks, but I've been working in finance for over 30 years now. But really, the last 20 years was 1999 when I joined my first dot-com startup. In the first dot-com boom, and that really was the start of my love affair with starting and scaling businesses. I'm a chaos monkey, so I'm really great in those early years when you have to wear many hats. So although I'd say I'm a finance person, I cover everything. I'm a fireside lawyer, I'm a HR specialist, I'm a logistics expert, and then I kind of knit the whole thing back together by still making sure that everything comes back to cash.
It's the thing I always kind of liked with working with you, is that you saw how it all connected. That's the piece I love. And that it wasn't just this silo of just look at the numbers. It was, what do the numbers mean? How do the other things affect it? How do we make the changes that we need to make? And even from a HR perspective, I've seen touch that, of how those kinds of things affect that. Like, it's always been impressed with how you connected those dots. Yes. And I like that you have a love affair with startups.
I'm nosy. I love to stick my beak into everything. I like to sit in open plan offices, and I love geeky technical people that talk in a language that I completely don't understand, and trying to take what they're saying and translate it into English and bring it all back into the business and see how we make. The other thing I'm really keen on is working in fun places and having work being as much fun as it can possibly be.
Yeah, why not?
Spend more of our life here than we do with our families. So you got to love it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. What would you say? So in our expert panel, you know that, and we're delighted to have you on board, I have to say that. We have 30 minutes that you can spend with somebody. And 30 minutes seems like it wouldn't be a lot. But I know from experience of working with great experts, you being one of them, that 30 minutes can make all the difference. So when are good times for a company to talk to you? When do you think they should reach out? Because I know often there's a hesitance of, I'm not ready to speak to a finance person. And often then they leave it too late. So when are good kind of milestones for you, them to talk to you?
Well, look, in an ideal world, before you ever incorporate, right? That would be the first time. When you have the business idea and you haven't done anything and you've committed to nothing, really, if I could get to them at that stage, that would be awesome.
Why?
In a real world, because I can help them with how they get their structures right from day one. Because the most important thing to think about, and we get to that later, is you know, not today, not your starting of your business, but what your exit is going to look like. So if you can put in groundwork at the very early stages, you can leave yourself with the foundations of a really super strong business that would be really easy to take investment into or to divest your shareholding in due course. So if I could talk to people before they ever incorporate anything, that would be amazing. But bearing in mind that that's not always practical, and normally people are already up in business and they start to have their pain points, then maybe the first time they're having that thought about, well, this could go international. We might be able, you know, this might be just something we sell in Waterford where we live. This might be something that we have our first potential prospect in the UK or in the US. That's another really good time to come and seek me out and have a chat with me about that. And maybe the third time would be when your systems are starting to creak. You know, a lot of people start up businesses and they're doing everything on an Excel spreadsheet for the first wee while, and then they suddenly have to register for a VAT and they have to think about a system. So that's another good opportunity to kind of reach out and have a connection with them.
So it's whenever they have this thought of getting bigger. And is it still good to talk to you even if they're not going to trade internationally?
Sure. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
Because that's still systems, yeah?
Yeah, it's still systems. It's still systems.
And I also find it very interesting that you raise this idea of exit, okay? Because I often have had a dilemma over this, because it's a double-edged sword. We want to commit to our business. And I often think sometimes when I meet, it's an interesting conversation because you, I always ask the question, if you're already thinking of exit, how committed are you to the business? So I'd love you to reframe that thinking for us.
So you don't have to think about it as an exit. What you want to do is with everything in life, you want to give yourself options. So if you do simple stuff very early on, you can leave yourself with a business that could be exitable. You don't have to build a business to sell. The business that I'm a co-founder in, at this stage of my life, I only co-founded a business myself 2 years ago. I don't want to. I'm not thinking about exit. I'm thinking about this being the business that takes me right through to retirement. However, I know that things can change. You could stumble across the best, whatever. You don't know what that is. You don't know where you're going to go in your journey. If you have a business that is capable of being easily absorbed into a bigger entity, that might help you to grow it so much faster. Exit doesn't have to mean you're selling and you're going off to hire a yacht and sit in the Caribbean. Exit can simply be that you're ready to take it to the next level, but you need significant investment and new partners in other territories that can help you do that. So yeah, the word exit is probably too final. It sounds too much like it's the end of the story, but it's not. It's just the next evolution.
No, I like that because I think that needs to be reframed for people, and it used to be something that bothered me when I heard it because I did think about that commitment, because you can't focus on growth if you're thinking about exit, but that's a lovely way of reframing it for everybody. Also like this idea of if they start talking to you early on, they start to expand their view of what the potential of their business could be. Is that fair to say?
Oh, that's very true. That's very true.
Because you're thinking what's possible. And I'm also kind of experience of you as you're always thinking about the business model. How does this work? How can we maybe change that business model to make it work, to have greater revenue, to make more sense from a profit perspective, or just how it works actually.
I had a great conversation with somebody last week that said, Fiona, you don't do pivots, you do pirouettes. And I thought that was such a lovely way of saying things. You know, pivot kind of sounds very kind of, we'll go up against the wall here. Oh my God, we've got to do something sharp. But pirouette, it's just, you know, it sounds more natural and graceful. And okay, we've tried this. It's not working. Let's just keep moving it around here until we find something that does work.
And the other thing that I take from this conversation is you start people thinking about the business being a separate identity from themselves. Because often when we have the identity of our businesses too close to ourselves, we can become too emotionally involved, and we often don't think clearly or logically, or we take too long to think clearly or logically about what actually is the next step.
Right. And the other benefit of thinking about your business as a baby and an entity in its own right is it makes it easier for you as a founder sometimes to make the hard decisions that affect you, because you have to do what's right for the business. And the business then really does become this living, breathing person in and of its own right. So things that might suit Fiona might not necessarily be the right thing for the business. When you start to think about it in that third person identity, I think it gets much easier to sort of divorce yourself then from just the selfish stuff, just what suits you. And sometimes that can mean thinking forward to, you know, you're the founder today, you're maybe the first chief executive, but you might not be the right chief executive in 3 years' time or 5 years' time when you go into another phase, and you have to start thinking about then, well, how do I do what's right for the, I'm going to call it the company. It isn't necessarily a company, but if what's the right thing for the company? Is this the right time to think
about it? Can you still think like this even if you're a sole trader?
Totally. Absolutely. Doesn't make any difference. That's why I don't like using just the word company, because it doesn't have to be a limited liability entity. It can be simply your own business that you just do your sole trading filings on. Makes no difference. You still need to think of it as something divorced from you.
Because sole traders are very often conditioned to think of them as tied.
Right.
Really good. I like that. Also very interesting about as the business changes, because as a business grows, the needs of the business grows. And I think it's very interesting that you say, how do you change your role? Because you may not be the right person to be at the helm in when the business evolves. Tell us more about that.
Well, you need to have a think about from the very start. And another part to think about is about remuneration and your executive and your founding team. If you're coming to this with more than one person, but generally speaking, and it's an overgeneralization, but generally speaking, chaos monkeys like myself, we're great in that 0 to 5 year old stage, because you're going to wear many hats, you're going to do lots of things, you're going to get stuck into the weeds, and you can make decisions today and implement them tomorrow. That's fine on revenues. Let's just pick a random number of anything up to maybe about 50 million. You get beyond that, then suddenly you've got maybe a couple of hundred people in your organization. You've got processes and procedures. You need to start making the jobs narrower. You can't really allow yourself the luxury of being able to make every decision in every department all of the time. You may not even be able to personally know everybody that works for you anymore. That's generally a skill set that somebody who wears a different kind of hat is better at, is more excellent at. So understanding where you are on your journey and having your milestones. And I what I normally do is I sort of set the milestones in advance. You know, we're going to check in at 5 million. We're going to check in at 7 million. We're going to check in at 10 million. And at that stage, just literally take time out, go away. Don't go into your normal workspace, go offsite. Look, what do we say we want to achieve here? How we got to this? How do we get to that next? Because generally speaking, these things come in big step ups. They're not all incremental. It doesn't just grow nice, that nice little line. It generally speaking, you go to here and then the next thing is a big leap. You then have to think about, well, who are the right resources to help me do that big leap? And I can include myself in that. I'm a very good CFO for that early stage startup. But when you start dealing with multi-million dollar deals, I'm not that CFO. That's somebody different. That's when it's time for me to say, okay, right, I need to either find a different role for myself in here or exit.
Yeah.
And you kind of have to be a bit ruthless about it. Okay. And if you've thought about it in advance and maybe written it down somewhere, it makes it easier then when you get there, because you can't keep changing the rules and going, well, I'll give it to 10 million. If you said in advance, no, I know the right time to look at this properly analytically is at that 5 million yardstick, then you have to hold yourself accountable to that and make sure you follow through.
I like that. And I like this use of the word ruthless, okay? And I want to talk about that for a second, because particularly women, I mean, I don't think men have as big an issue with this, but the word ruthless, I think, is really useful. And it's kind of, it's not such a negative word. It actually can be an extremely positive word when you make decisions for your business. And I think you alluded to it with holding yourself accountable. Tell me a bit more about that, because you can still be a good person and still be ruthless. You know what I mean? It doesn't mean you're evil, you know what I mean? All businesses,
you're not Cruella de Vil going around killing all the Dalmatians to have your fur coat. It is having that discipline to follow through on decisions that aren't necessarily emotional. And maybe that's the piece that sometimes as women we do struggle with, in that we do, I certainly come to things from an emotional perspective initially, and then I bring in the logical piece behind it. But the ruthless decisions have to be that logical piece. They do need to be the ones that are a little bit colder, a little bit more analytic, and a bit more about really ruthlessly looking at those skill sets. What is knowing yourself? So if you've given yourself the time to be very self-aware, you understand your competencies and where you're strong, you also have to embrace your weaknesses. Know that, and for some of us, those weaknesses are inherent traits. So that's why I call myself the chaos monkey. I know I love to do a little bit of everything, but I get bored if I'm left doing the same thing in great detail, highly granular all the time. It just doesn't work for me. It doesn't excite me. It doesn't get me out of bed.
You're not at your best.
I don't give my best. No, I don't give my best, because I don't like to use the word bored, but I get bored. If I'm bored, I'm not giving 100%. So that's where the ruthless piece comes in of reining myself in. And I'd never advise anybody to do something I haven't done myself. And I can still recall the day when I worked in a telecoms company, when we got to that point where I had given as much as I could give to it. I understood, although I think I was a VP of finance, but the company suddenly needed a CFO. We were doing this really, really, really big, serious funding round. We were going to get into a due diligence process that was gnarly and boring and elongated. And I hadn't done it before, so I didn't have the skill set, I hadn't got the experience, and I didn't have the interest. Mm. So it was time for me to do something different. So what we did in that instance, the company didn't want to lose me at that time, so we changed my role. I took a broader role. I moved into regulatory and I took on HR for a while. But it was the start of me transitioning out of the business. And that's not something to be afraid of either. You know, there's always the next opportunity. This doesn't have to be forever.
I like that. There's always the next opportunity. Even like, because we're used to talking about there's always the next opportunity for a business, but even for ourselves, there's always the next opportunity as our own roles in our own businesses. So, I mean, yes. Good.
Yes. Good. Try something different. Yeah, try something.
Love it, love it. So let me ask you. So this is great because I really want people to get a sense of what you can do for them. And so it's broad, but it's also kind of exciting. And what I want people to think about when they think of you, Fiona, is that they can get you when it's just an idea in their head. They can get you when they're thinking about the systems, and they can get you at that rate where they're thinking of going international. And quite a nice partnership in ways, because you can help them go through those stages. So that's a very, very powerful resource to have on this panel. So we're delighted to have you. So fantastic. So my last question for you today is, I love this one because it helps people walk away with something, which is your three tips for entrepreneurs. What would they be?
Okay, right. So if you're setting up a company and you're doing it with more than one person, get your shareholders' agreement sorted up front. Okay. Do not delay. That is probably the best single legal spend you will make on your whole process. You'll never be as in love with each other as you are when you're giving birth to this new baby, this new idea. So get your shareholders' agreement. Agreed yourselves personally offsite in words in plain English, and then go and find yourself a kind, honest lawyer who speaks plain English back to you, who can translate it into the legal gobbledygook. Then sign it and put it in a filing cabinet, and hopefully you will never, never, ever, ever need to look at it again. So that would be the first
thing. I will interject here because we have a wonderful solicitor on this expert panel who doesn't speak in gobbledygook, and I can absolutely vouch for her. So great, okay.
Number two, decide up front what you're going to do for the people that are working for you. So if they're not co-founders with you, but you've got key employees that join with you on this journey on day one, know what you're offering them and be really clear about what you're offering them and perhaps what you're not offering them. So don't leave any ambiguity there. If you want this to be all your family business, you want to keep the shares and all to yourself, be really straight with the people that are starting this with you about that. That's not on the table if that's not what you're offering. So let everybody that's starting with you be very, very, very clear about what's in it for them.
Has that happened in your experience where employees have an expectation, maybe in a tech startup or something, that they'll ultimately get that?
Oh, lots of times, more times than I care. And it can be an implicit thing. And often a naivety on part of employees who, you know, generally speaking, founder stands back, you know, family holds back when it comes to taking wages and salaries in the early years. You look after the employees, but the lines can get very blurred about what it is that they brought to the table and what they thought by virtue of maybe being in all the decisions from early on. They can feel as if they own this with you, even if they don't. And if you choose to go co-ownership, as we do in Fourth Theorem, then that's a very straight conversation. It's a very easy one to have up front. But if you're not going that route, you also need to have that conversation up front. Okay. So everybody knows where they stand from the beginning. Again, it just means that the focus can then be all about the business, and everybody knows exactly what they're getting out of this and what they're not getting out of it.
And I think the employees are, you know, find that honesty refreshing anyway. And they appreciate it. And they basically can make an informed decision.
And they might stay with you or they might leave you. And better that they leave you early than go along and then we find things that get soured at a very important time when you perhaps they're in a position that you really, really, really need them, but they thought they were getting this and you thought you were only ever offering them that. And then the third thing is going to be much more boring. It's much more accounting based, and it is pick a system from the start. Don't start your business on Excel. Please do not do that. Do not do a VAT return off an Excel spreadsheet. You are setting yourself up for pain, pain, pain. You don't need to reinvent the wheel, and your system doesn't need to do absolutely everything. Get something that's good enough. There's plenty of them out there. There's QuickBooks, there's Xero. If you have a small group, there's Accounts IQ that you can get in on an entry level that I'm just doing with one of the clients I'm working with at the moment. Pick a system that's safe, that you can kick the tires on, that you could talk to people, ideally find somebody who's in a similar business to you and ask them, what are you using? And use that.
And of course, you can help them choose it.
I can, of course. Loved it. I've tried them all.
Fantastic. I love it. Brilliant. And anything else you'd like to leave them with?
No, except to wish them all the best, because this is the craziest, most exciting time in their lives. And they're all a bit nuts. But I love nuts people.
I love it. Cool. Brilliant. Thank you so much. And again, let me introduce you to Fiona McKenna. And do spend some time with her and take advantage of working with her to help you grow your business as part of this expert panel. Thank you again, Fiona. Wonderful speaking to you.
Thanks, Finola.
Cool. Bye. You're unstoppable. You're unstoppable.